Hi everyone, I'm Michael Short. This is Let's Go Outdoors.
Let's go outdoors where the waters run clear and cold. Mother Nature's world is better than gold. So much to see, so much to do. Let's go outdoors, me and you.
Let's Go Outdoors with Michael Short. Supported by the Alberta Conservation Association.
Hi everyone, welcome to Let's Go Outdoors. I'm Michael Short.
And I'm Elma Mehmedbegovic.
Coming up, we take a step back in time to rediscover the art of flint knapping.
From old boreal growth forests to wetlands and beaches, we will discover the many dimensions of Sir Winston Churchill Park.
You can see the great blue heron is out there on the wetland.
All anglers have to first pass the fish ID test.
Imagine having to write a test to go fishing. Not only passing it, but having to achieve a 100% mark. We'll meet one dedicated angler a little later on.
We will also have this story.
Hi guys, Fish and Wildlife.
Hi.
Just coming in to check licenses.
Hey everyone, welcome to another edition of Let's Go Outdoors. We've been following Mary over the last number of episodes. She works her way towards her first hunt.
And that day has finally arrived. Jason Offner, a former professional waterfowl guide, agreed to spend a day with Mary, teaching her the finer points of waterfowl hunting at a location near Camrose.
You got stuff in your fur already. See the duck?
Awesome.
So, our first experience.
Okay, so your duck throwing skills might need a little work, eh, Mary? But then that's what this day is all about. Learning the ins and outs of waterfowl hunting. And the day actually starts before arriving at the pothole.
We did some spotting this morning. We were driving and found some ducks, and then we went and talked to the landowner, and he graciously gave us permission. He was very excited to allow us to have this opportunity.
Now, Mary may not quite know what she has gotten herself into for the day, but she's starting to look the part.
This is the immunity idol.
The Medal of Honor. It's like Alberta's version of the lei in Hawaii.
So with the decoys in place, it was time to go over some of the finer points.
The ducks typically are going to come from straight in front of us, Mary. We are on the upwind side of this pond. So
they're coming against the wind.
Exactly. So like any aircraft or good pilots, they're going to come and land into the wind. Head down.
Now armed with some new information, nothing left to do but hunker down and hope some ducks will be enticed to fly into this little pothole. And you know, it didn't take long for the first duck to approach, but showing some good judgment, Mary holds off.
Two's too low. Too low now.
That's good. That's good. Good restraint. You don't have a clear shot.
Yet another duck makes the approach.
Okay.
It's looking good.
Oh, my safety's on.
Oh, it's okay.
Oh, bummer.
And as the afternoon carries on, Mary starts to get some pretty good chances. Now Mary's persistence is about to pay off. It's late in the afternoon, and it looks like a perfect setup.
Pick one on the feet. Pick one.
Yeah! I got him!
You got him!
I shot him right on!
You got him! I shot!
I better put the safety
on!
Celebrate!
Nice job! We're gonna let Chubbs go get him?
Go get him, Chubbs! Jason, thank you very much for all of your patience and guidance during my very first hunt. I'm really excited to take the ducks home and then start some of those recipes that we were talking about. So I just wanted to thank you so much for everything.
My pleasure. They're going to make some great meals for you, Mary. It was absolutely a treat to have you out. And I think we're going to see you as an avid lady waterfowler going forward.
I will be doing this again for sure.
Great.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Now, Mary's day also included a visit from a fish and wildlife officer while she was hunting.
Well, let's see if she has her ducks in order.
Hi, guys. Fish and Wildlife.
Hi. How are you?
Good. Just coming in to check licenses, and
yeah.
I was wondering if you could
pull
them out for me. So how's the bird hunting today?
Good.
So far, so good. Here you go. This is my migratory bird stamp.
And what's your first name?
Mary.
Mary. And how long have you been hunting, Mary?
This is my very first time.
First time?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, it's great to see new people in the sport.
While you're here, I was just going to ask you a little bit about bag limits.
Okay, bag limits for ducks are 8 a day, of which only 4 can be pintails. Because of the population, we only allow people to harvest 4. Mm-hmm. When you get into the ducks and geese, your white snow geese, you're allowed 20 a day. So that includes Ross geese also. And then when you get into white-fronted geese, you're allowed 5 a day of 8 total gray limits. So if you have a combined limit of 8 of Canada geese and white fronts, the most you can have of the white fronts is 5. But you can top up your limit with the other 3 Canadas to have a total of 8, or you can take all 8 Canadas. So.
Okay, so for someone like me who's brand new to this and maybe is like still working on wildlife identification, what happens if I accidentally like do 9 of something, or you know, like I accidentally have one more pintail? What would I do?
Best thing to do there if you do that is phone the report of poacher line and say, you know, I took a shot, I ended up one extra bird.
Yeah.
That way they're aware and they notify the officers that there's been a mistake made.
Yeah.
And it's easier to do that than I come in the field and say, hey, you got one over your limit. How come don't you know how to count? It's great to see a new hunter out here, and we're seeing more and more women all the time, and that's great to see.
So I'm going to tell all my lady
guys
friends.
Sure. Get back to it, and hopefully you're successful. And did you have any birds yet?
Not yet, no. Just the decoys that I had failed to throw into the water properly. But well, thank you very much.
Okay, have a great
day.
It
was nice meeting you. Take care. I passed the inspection.
Way to go, Mary.
I'm glad we didn't have to bail her out. Hey, if you're planning to spend any time in the backcountry, always a good idea to have some bear spray with you.
And if you're going to carry it, then you should have a good idea of how to use it. Dr. Mike Sullivan is a provincial biologist who spends a great deal of time in bear territory and has some helpful hints to using bear spray.
Backcountry safety, always something that should be on top of your mind. And if you're in an area where you know that bears call home, always a good idea to be carrying one of these. It is a bear repellent. Dr. Mike Sullivan, biologist with Alberta Sustainable Resource Development, joins me. Mike, just how important is it to have something like this?
Yeah, the chance of having a bear attack or contact is really slim. That puts it to slim to none. You know, a bear you meet on the trail can happen anytime. This has been shown pretty good scientific studies now out of Alaska that shows it works just fine on both blacks and grizzlies. Less data on polar bears, but for the stuff we're gonna meet around here, this is an excellent deterrent.
I guess it's like any other tool. You do need to at least know how this thing works, so perhaps a good idea at home in the backyard under good conditions, you should get familiar with this thing.
You practice with it. They got an expiry date on it. Yours expires in 2013, so that summer of expiry, take it out to some place, some farmer's field that you know, or someplace, and fire it off. Learn what it sounds like, learn what the recoil is like, learn that you have to use a two-handed grip on it. Get used to the idea. When my daughter and I go backpacking a lot, we'll take last year's and we'll have a session of, hey, there's a stump. Okay, act like it's a bear. And you, hey, bear, don't even try this. I'm right here, biologist coming through, and fire it off. You know, talk firmly to the bear, let him know you're a human, let him know you're not scared, and you design, you determine a line. You know, maybe 3 meters, 5 meters, you pick that in your mind. A bear's coming at you, there's a lot of things going on. If you already know what a 3 meter line looks like, and you know what this is gonna sound like, you're way more comfortable, you're gonna hit him in the face. It's not gonna stop the charge forever. He's going to back off. It's gonna give you both time to think about the situation, and if there's a kill around, if there's cubs around, you leave. It gives him time to calm down and leave. It just lets everybody have a sober second thought for 10 minutes and get out of the situation.
Of course, another important backcountry skill is how to find and safely drink water. We talked to Mike about some of the challenges you might face while on a backcountry hike.
We sort of warn people to be careful, but in my experience, I drink out of this, 100 days of the year. We often like a cup of tea or a cup of instant coffee on the trail. As soon as the first bubbles start to form, the Giardia is killed off. So if we're all dicey about it, man, just boil up a cup of tea and drink that, Let the tea pail cool off and fill your water bottle with that. But a little boiling is generally all you need. Or just, this is your most important piece of safety gear. Use it. See where that's coming from. Right here, it's just coming from those rocks, from a snow patch. It's very likely just fine. And if you got good water quality, I say enjoy it. Tell your kids about it. It's important to keep the perspective that there are places where the water is clean enough that you can scoop it up and drink it.
Coming up, we explore Alberta's only provincial park that's on an island.
The Alberta Conservation Association is proud to be partnered with Alberta Fish and Game Association, Alberta Hunter Education Instructors Association, Alberta Professional Outfitters Society.
Time now for a look at our outdoor community calendar.
So if someone told you that in order to fish a particular stream, you would have to pass an exam first, do you think you'd be up to that task?
I don't know if I would be, but you're about to meet a pretty dedicated angler who accepted the challenge. We put him to the test at Quirk Creek, west of Calgary.
Before you can harvest fish here, you need to pass an exam. That is, if you want to get involved with the province's stewardship license project. It's a program where anglers can catch and keep unlimited numbers of brook trout, considered to be an invasive species, but you must be able to identify the difference between brook trout, cutthroat, and bull trout.
So, Paul?
Yeah, to participate in the stewardship license pilot project, all anglers have to first pass the fish ID test. There's three different species involved, a total of 16 pictures, and you have to correctly identify them all.
In this case, the exam is being administered by Jim Stelfox, a fisheries biologist with the province, and it requires a mark of 100% in order to pass. So it takes some dedication to want to get involved.
Some encouragement from some fellow co-workers that I work with, Robert Boyce of our environment group. He encouraged me to get along. He knows that I've been quite interested in fly fishing for a number of years, and I thought this would be a good extension to my knowledge.
Being connected to the outdoors in this way has sharpened Paul's perception when he returns from a day fishing and ready to get on with the day-to-day task with Devon Energy.
I mean, the more time you get to spend outdoors and looking around the province, the more you appreciate the natural beauty that we have right here in our backyard. So, when we're building new roads and lease sites and that kind of thing, you want to make sure that you're minimizing impact wherever we can and make sure we're not damaging anything and being careful where we're going.
With the exam out of the way, Paul, along with other dedicated volunteers, will continue to walk the miles of streams to ensure our native bull trout and cutthroat populations have a chance to reclaim these foothill streams.
So, Michael, I understand that you also got involved in this project. Care to share with us your test results?
Well, I'll be happy to, Alma, but you're going to have to wait until a future episode. Hey, if there's one thing you can say about Sir Winston Churchill Park, it's the fact that it shows many different moods. Kind of like you, Alma.
Ha ha, very funny, Michael. But you are right, as I discovered this park has a lot going for it.
We get a lot of people coming actually from many parts around the world to come here to visit.
Meet our tour guide, Allison Kerr. She says Sir Winston Churchill Park provides habitat for over 230 different species of birds. Do you see the long-legged one standing on the other side of the marsh?
As you can see, the great blue heron is out there on the wetland, probably looking for a snack of a frog or something like that in the area.
You said that you do school programs here. What kind of a reaction do you get from kids? Oh, there he goes.
Maybe the great blue heron will return when students are visiting. Roughly 1,200 come each year to learn about the biodiversity of this park.
One of the great things about this island is that it's an old growth forest. There hasn't been a fire here in at least 350 years.
The reason for that? This is the only provincial park in Alberta surrounded by water. This causeway built in the late 60s is the only land access. With an abundance of nature trails, there's always something new waiting to be discovered.
Oh, I see some bear scat here.
Oh.
It's actually kind of exciting for us. We don't often have a lot of bear activity on the island. Last fall was the first time that a bear had been seen in quite a few years here on the island.
Well, I never thought I'd be excited about something like this, but I guess you've enlightened me.
Bears are just one of several fur-bearing animals found in this area.
Allison, how do you use these in your presentations?
The people that come to visit get a good chance to have a really close look at some of these animals that normally we wouldn't want to get anywhere near.
So what kind of furs do we have here?
So the first one here is the cougar. This is the largest member of the cat family that we have in the area. And the next one here is the lynx with its long tufts on its ears and its short little tail. We have here the largest member of the dog family, which is the wolf. And it is quite large indeed. If the wolf were standing on its back legs, it would be taller than you.
Wow.
The next one is the coyote, and the smallest member of the dog family that we have is the red fox. So another one of the old growth species of trees that we have here is the balsam fir, and you can usually tell the balsam fir by the fact that their needles come off flat off the branches, so they're actually quite a bit softer than the other coniferous trees that we have. Mm-hmm. Not everybody sees the beauty in a dead tree.
Old snags like this are an important habitat for woodpeckers and bats.
They use them for roosting, and we have definitely a large population of bats on this island, which helps us to keep the mosquito population down.
I'm all for that.
Wow, Allison, to go from an old growth forest to a beautiful beach, I mean, that's just something amazing.
This is another great spot to view some of the wildlife, definitely some of the water birds that we have in the area.
Marty and Joanne from High Level are here for the first time. They're very impressed with what they're seeing.
We were just out on our bikes this morning and thought it looked like a reasonable distance, so we came out.
Does it get any better? Sun, sand?
It's beautiful.
Yeah, pleasantly surprised.
Sir Winston Churchill Provincial Park has 72 campsites, and in summer, you would be wise to reserve in advance. These well-treed, secluded sites are very popular.
And you don't really see the people next door. Though yesterday we had a fiddler, so that was a really nice touch to the stay here.
This is Pelican Viewpoint. As you can see, we have a really great view of Pelican Island from here. That's a colonial nesting site for pelicans as well as cormorants and some species of gulls that we see here.
In 2010, the park was expanded to include 8 other islands on Lake Lac La Biche. The lake offers excellent fishing for trout, pike, perch, walleye, whitefish, and burbot.
Allison, thank you for showing us around the park and introducing us to the various activities people can do here.
My pleasure.
And folks, the opportunity to explore Sir Winston Churchill Provincial Park awaits you as well.
So, Alma, your favorite part of the park was?
Oh, I loved the beaches and the pelicans in the sky. Gorgeous.
Yeah, they were special. Hey, coming up, Brad Fanson will have some thoughts about selecting the right kind of fishing line.
The Alberta Conservation Association is proud to be partnered with Alberta Trappers Association. Nature Alberta. Wild Sheep Foundation Alberta.
Time now for a look at our outdoor community calendar.
How the oil and gas sector impacts our land base is the topic of much debate.
It's a discussion the industry itself wants to participate in. For over a decade now, oil and gas officials get together each year with environmental experts and government officials to share ideas at a seminar in Calgary.
For 11 years, this event has provided a platform for environmental experts within and outside the oil and gas sector to interact with industry officials to talk about issues they see from the field.
It's really grown in both numbers and in participation in terms of presenters. You know, we've expanded it to government folks who work the policy and regulatory issues. And really what it does is help us see what's coming at us in terms of expectations from our policy and regulatory environment, and helps our members adapt to planning for that for their projects and their approvals.
While the oil and gas industry is a competitive playing field, it's seminars like this which provide a stage to address common issues.
A lot of the issues we have are issues in common, how we're going to manage for different air quality objectives when we work closely in a region. So we do need to talk to each other and look at strategies that ensure that collectively we're managing within the expectations for a region for, say, levels for air quality or impacts on water use and that sort of thing. So it becomes really important for us to work together. And it's really important, for the government and the regulators to see that industry is aligned in responding to their policies and their direction. And through CAP, we've got many, many committees that are aligned with the different issues that we face, that we bring these people together as to understand them as well. So it's not just conferences like this, but we do work well together and in great strength to work those issues.
Meetings like this are more than just bouncing off ideas, though. There are substantive results, especially when it comes to working with all levels of government.
We bring a common industry perspective to the table, and that lets government understand that we are an important constituent in terms of how government governs the economy. And it's helpful for them to understand what role we think we can play in helping them meet their objectives.
Right now, Brad Fanson is going to string us along as he talks about fishing line.
Hi, I'm Brad Fanson with the Alberta Fish and Game Association with your outdoor tip of the week. It's fishing season, and we're so blessed in Alberta to have such a wide diversity of fisheries, everything from deep reservoirs in the south to rivers, lakes, even stocked ponds. If you really want to take an advantage for some of those applications, you should really have a look at the braided lines that are available. They really do give you an advantage on some specific fisheries, and especially when you're fishing deep water or current. There's absolutely no stretch in this. It's a much lower diameter than monofilament line, yet higher breaking strength. When we look at monofilament line and we're out fishing with it, it actually has a lot of stretch in it. And that's just to help provide some forgiveness so that it doesn't break easy. But you can take a foot of monofilament line and stretch it out several inches. Can you imagine fishing in deep water, having to pull all that stretch out before you feel it? Using braided line allows you to feel them quickly, and being able to feel a fish is the key to catching them. So again, in the rivers with currents, this will cut through the water much easier. It won't bow out and create some slack line. So let's go fishing and give it a try, and we'll show you how it works. You know, you don't have to give up your monofilament line, and you don't have to buy a second reel either. Most reels nowadays will actually come with a second spool, or you can go back to your favorite tackle shop and purchase one. Now, if you're fishing the braided lines, they are a thinner diameter, so you will have to put some backing on a regular spool, or they now sell them ready to go. They're shallower in depth so that you can put it on there a full spool, and you can just head out fishing. You can interchange the spools and fish with your mono or braided line, depending on what you're after.
Coming up, it's called flint knapping, and it's one of the oldest forms of tool making known to man.
The Alberta Conservation Association is proud to be partnered with Pheasants Forever, Alberta Council, Treaty 8, First Nations of Alberta, Trout Unlimited Canada.
Time now for a look at our outdoor community calendar.
It is considered by experts to be one of the oldest technologies in the world. I'm talking about flint knapping.
Some archaeologists feel the making of stone tools can be traced back to 3 million years ago. And as you're about to see, it's not a lost technology.
I guess you could say what was once old is new again. Webb Hammond has traveled across North America teaching anyone who cares to learn on how to flint knap. Of course, back thousands of years ago, these stone arrowheads meant whether or not you could put meat on the table. Today, these stone shapes represent more of an art form than weapon.
I do probably half and half artwork and functional tools. I use what I make, but I also do it for a living and sell the knives or, you know, jewelry, things like that, out of all the different stone, obsidian, flint, jasper, chert. You know, there's stone all over the world that we can use for this stuff.
Well, considered to be more art than function, in the skilled hands of Webb, these arrowheads combined with his homemade bow can still pack a bit of a punch.
I'm going to hit it on the edge and I'll just start shaping this. And the only part that should make contact with the stone is the tip of the billet.
And if you think you're only limited to using some kind of exotic stone to create your work of art, well, think again.
So you can use ceramic, you know, modern glass, TV screen. The old screens have really thick glass or bottle bottoms. It's endless.
You're just trying to hit it with the very tip of that billet.
For these guys, getting an opportunity to take a course like this has been worthwhile, even when the slightest mistake can mean a cut finger.
Oh, did you really? You cut yourself?
I think it's fun. I think it's neat. Anything you can make out of nature is always, well, that's kind of who we are, right? We're trying to connect people to wildlife and wild places and natural ways. And if we can find a way to make people enjoy something that they can, like, pick up a rock out of the woods and turn it into something relatively functional, that's kind of cool.
And by the end of the course, some pretty nice pieces had been turned out.
On behalf of all of us, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Cool.
That's pretty impressive work for some first-time flint knapping.
Yeah, I would have been the one cutting my finger for sure. Hey, if you'd like to catch previous stories featured on Let's Go Outdoors, then track down our website, letsgooutdoors.ca.
And remember, the outdoors is here for all of us to enjoy. So if you see someone taking away from that enjoyment, call the Report a Poacher line. Till next time, I'm Elma Mehmedbegovic.
And I'm Michael Short. Let's Go Outdoors.
I know where I want to be, outside, wild and free. Let's go outdoors, let's go outdoors, you and me. Let's go outdoors where the waters run clear and cold. Mother Nature's world is better than gold. So much to see, so much to do. Let's go outdoors, me and you. Let's go outdoors.